Hello students, welcome to today's class. Today we'll be continuing with the history of abnormal psychology. Where we stopped last, we saw how by the end of the 19th century, the mental hospital had become a landmark of the European society, a landmark meant to isolate the people who were mentally ill, and a landmark which was looked upon with a lot of fear and which was looked upon as something very different from normal lives by the normal citizens. Now, towards the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, a movement began to improve the deplorable conditions of the mental hospitals and to recognize the inhuman treatment given to the patients therein and the need to change it. Now, one such landmark was the publication of the book The Mind That Found Itself by Clifford Beers in 1908. Now, what was really landmark about this book was that it was a very authentic experience put forward by Clifford Beers, because he himself was a patient who had suffered from some kind of mental trauma and who had the experience of living in three mental hospitals of those times. And finally, he did take refuge in the house of a kind attendant and recovered. And when he recovered, he put forward a book which enumerated the kind of inhuman treatment that he and other mental patients with him had to suffer. Certain practices such as chaining and other torture devices had been eliminated, of course, but the straitjacket and such other practices were still there. And Clifford Beers very authentically and very movingly describes how horrible the pain was to be put in a straitjacket. And this movement by Clifford Beers soon gained support from other progressive theorists and researchers such as William James, who is also known as the Dean of American Psychiatry, Adolf Meyer, and others. Through the efforts of Clifford Beers and other followers, a number of mental hospitals were established for a number of severe mental disorders such as schizophrenia or tertiary syphilis and so on. And also there was some improvement in the condition of the mental hospitals. Now by 1940, the public institutions or the public mental hospitals housed more than 4 lakh people. And in spite of the efforts of Beers and others, the condition of patients in these overcrowded mental hospitals was not very good, and things were not very positive. Also, towards the 1940s and 1950s, another dangerous trend emerged, because the medical model was slowly emerging, but it was not fully developed. So the medical practitioners did not have a clear knowledge of medical treatments. Their understanding was very vague and hazy. And on the basis of this half-truths and half-understandings which they possessed, they actually implemented treatments. For instance, up to the 1940s and 1950s, a very crude surgery called the prefrontal lobotomy was being performed on patients who were uncontrollable in some way, who got very aggressive or very excited. It involved destruction of the prefrontal cortex in a very crude way. And the result was that most of the patients who underwent this surgery emerged back in a vegetative state, and the remaining died. Now, the year 1946 was an important landmark in the exodus or the movement away from the hospitals or the process of deinstitutionalization. In 1946, Mary Jane Ward published her book The Snake Pit, and in her book The Snake Pit, she described in detail the kind of inhuman practices which were going on in the overcrowded mental hospitals, and also the need to develop a more community integrative approach in which the mental patients would be treated, looked after, and rehabilitated in the community rather than being isolated in mental hospitals. Similarly, the National Institutes of Mental Health were organized during that time, and they developed residency programs in psychiatry as also the earliest clinical psychology programs. There were two other pioneering things that happened. The first was the Hill-Burton Act, and the second was the Community Mental Health Services Act. Now, these two acts provided a great impetus to the development of outpatient psychiatric clinics, where the patients could come, get themselves treated or get prescriptions and go back home rather than remaining in the mental hospital. So also inpatient care in general hospitals which would mean that mental patients were also treated in ways similar to patients suffering from other illnesses in the general hospital, rather than isolating them to a separate hospital. And other methods for community rehabilitation, community treatment, and community integration. Now, the need to improve the mental hospitals was further strengthened in the 1950s and the 1960s by a number of works. One important work is the book Asylums by Irving Goffman, who was a noted sociologist. And then again, this was also the time that the medical model was slowly developing. A new class of tranquilizers or sedatives were developed. Phenothiazines, for instance, which could help treat patients with schizophrenia, or lithium, which could help treat manic depressive patients. Now, with the introduction of sedatives, people became more confident that they could actually manage these patients and the patients would no longer become uncontrollable. And hence, they were more open to keeping these patients in the community rather than isolating them into the mental hospitals. Now, this phenomenon of deinstitutionalization, which probably began since the 1940s or precisely 1946, is a phenomenon which continues even today on an international basis across countries. And the motive behind deinstitutionalization then and even now was the fact that being in the community would give a greater motivation for the patient to recover, to get back to his normal life, rather than isolating himself in the hospital, losing all reality orientation, and actually becoming accustomed to the sick role and becoming a permanent patient or a permanent resident of the mental hospital. Now, although deinstitutionalization had a very good motive behind it, still the application of the same did not reach the expected standards. For instance, the hospitals did close down to a large extent and people were sent back to the community. But due to the absence of adequate funds, proper community mechanisms such as community mental health clinics and other rehabilitative programs and treatments could not be developed. And the result was many of the patients now didn't have a place in the hospitals, didn't have a place in the community, and ended up homeless. Now, this discussion or this argument of which is the best approach, whether institutionalization or deinstitutionalization, continues even today. For instance, there is the new movement of community psychology, and especially in India, it is gaining momentum. And community psychologists say, especially in India, that mental health services should be integrated with public health services. There are two reasons for this. The first is that it will make mental health services less of a stigma, less of something that you're going to a different mental hospital to get yourself treated. They can treat themselves in the general hospitals as well, like other patients suffering from other illnesses. The second is to increase accessibility, because in any rural area, there may be a public health center, but you won't find a mental hospital. So by introducing mental health care into the public health care system, and by introducing community rehabilitation and treatment, the accessibility of mental health services increases. But the debate still continues, and the debate is not actually one between institutionalization and deinstitutionalization. It is actually the lack of balance that is being followed, the lack of balance in adjusting inpatient treatment and outpatient treatment, community rehabilitation and mental hospital rehabilitation, integrating all these facilities, making sure that the programs are implemented and filling the gaps in between. This is the main problem. Now that we have almost come into the modern times from the prehistoric times in our journey of the history of abnormal psychology, we'll now look at four views that emerged, or four themes that emerged in the 20th century, that is the latter half of the 19th and the early part of the 20th century, and which influenced our contemporary views on abnormal behavior. The first such theme is biological discoveries. Now, biological discoveries in the early part of the 20th century sought to establish the link between mental disorders and brain pathology. And there were a number of studies of human anatomy and other physiological processes which sought to establish that mental disorders may have an organic basis in brain pathology. Now, there was one incident which provided a great impetus to this field. It was the recognition that general paresis, which was actually considered to be a very severe mental disorder, was actually an advanced case of syphilis, a sexually transmitted disease. And when this disease of syphilis advanced to its progressed stages, general paresis resulted, which was a degenerative change, an irreversible degenerative change in physical and mental functioning. Now, this discovery provided a great impetus to the biological model, and it placed the biomedical model at a very high and lofty position. And in fact, it occupies this position even today. Now, there were other things also which promoted the biological model. For instance, in 1757, that is in the latter half of the 18th century, Albrecht von Haller published his book Elements of Physiology, in which he established that brain pathology was an important cause of mental disorders, and he advocated a dissection and study of the anatomy of the brain through postmortem, that is after the person has died. Similarly, there was Wilhelm Griesinger, a German psychiatrist, who published his book The Pathology and Therapy of Psychic Disorders. In this also, he felt that all mental disorders had their roots in brain pathology. Similarly, Alois Alzheimer, who first discovered or identified Alzheimer's disease, put forward his theory of brain arteriosclerosis and other such pathological changes which led to senile dementia or memory loss and a host of other physical and mental symptoms. Now, one thing we must remember here is that many of these biological discoveries answered the question as to how mental disorders were caused. But many people erroneously felt or wrongly felt that it also answered the question why, or the answer of causation. But no, biological discoveries told us how many of the disorders were caused, how they progressed. But whether this brain pathology or the process which caused mental disorders was again caused by psychological or physiological changes is a question which has not been answered in the case of many disorders. For instance, we know the process which leads to Alzheimer's. There are plaques which are formed, there is cerebral arteriosclerosis, there are clumps, and there is a degeneration of brain tissue. This is how Alzheimer's is caused, but till today, we do not know why Alzheimer's is caused. Now, the second important theme occurring in the 20th century, which has influenced our contemporary understanding of abnormal behavior, is the development of a classification system. Today, we know that we have classification systems in clinical psychology, such as the DSM or the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, or the ICD or the International Classification of Diseases. But the roots of this form of classification, of course, we have reached advanced stages of classification today, but the roots can be traced back to one influential person, that is Emil Kraepelin. Now, Emil Kraepelin put forward the earliest classification system of mental disorders, and it has had a great influence on all subsequent classifications, including the DSM. Now, Kraepelin noted that certain symptoms of diseases occurred in certain patterns which were connected to each other, and that these patterns were connected enough that based on these patterns, you could divide the symptoms as belonging to different mental disorders or diseases. And he also felt that the course and the outcomes of the diseases could be predicted. Now, what Kraepelin did in those times was a Herculean task. It was a really difficult task because the information regarding mental disorders was much of the information was very primitive, the other was advanced, the information was scattered. Now, he brought all this information together and put it forward in the form of some really useful classification systems in mental disorder. And although today we may see some of his classifications as primitive, we must understand the kind of important work he did for his time. Now, another thing that we need to thank for our development of contemporary abnormal psychology is the military administration of those times, because many of these psychologists, including Emil Kraepelin, worked with the military administration during the World Wars, and it was the military administration which gave them a huge impetus because they wanted to understand the various factors which could affect the performance of duty by the soldiers. And so they promoted research in the field of psychology, and many researchers such as Emil Kraepelin, as we know, he developed the classification system, or Richard Kraft Ebing, who actually started the inoculation process for general paresis, all of them worked with the military administration. Now we come to the third theme that influenced our contemporary understanding of abnormal psychology, and this is the psychological causation views. Now, as the biological views of causation were developing, so also the psychological causation views were beginning to develop. Now, even though the real development in psychological causation views happened with Sigmund Freud, still we can trace the roots back to the late 19th and early 20th centuries to a person named Franz Anton Mesmer. Now, Franz Anton Mesmer believed that our bodies contain magnetic fluids and magnetic forces, and these are affected by planetary movements. And hence, by affecting or influencing the magnetic forces of the body, this composition of the fluid can be changed and mental disorders can be prevented or cured. Thus, Mesmer put forward his theory of animal magnetism, and he had a kind of elaborate procedure which he followed in his clinics. For instance, the patients used to sit around in the darkness. They used to sit in the darkness around a tub containing certain chemicals, and iron rods used to protrude from the tubs. And Mesmer used to feel that by touching each of these iron rods or some of these iron rods to specific patients, the composition of the magnetic fluid could be balanced. And then Mesmer himself used to appear in a lilac robe, and he used to move around the patients, touching them with his wand. And there were a lot of practices which we may be quite amused to hear of today. But even unknown to Mesmer himself, of course his ideas were primitive, but even unknown to himself, what he was doing was hypnosis. And hence, even though his entire idea of animal magnetism was primitive, yet his treatments were effective, because what he was using was nothing but hypnotism or the power of suggestion. Now, Mesmer's findings were further re-examined by two French physicians. One of these was Ambrose Auguste Liébault, and the other was Hippolyte Mary Burnham. Now, both of them studied this process of hypnosis, and they were from Nancy in eastern France, and they developed the Nancy School. Their school became known as the Nancy School, their school of thought. And they believed that hysteria, which was earlier, as we know, seen to be caused by a wandering uterus, was in fact nothing but a self-hypnosis. Now, there was another person, Jean Charcot, who actually refuted this view. Charcot believed that hysteria was caused by nothing else rather than brain pathology. He rejected this psychological notion of self-hypnosis. And this kind of argument between Charcot and the Nancy School continued for years. It is one of the most well-documented arguments in history. And finally, Charcot himself accepted that his views were wrong, that hysteria had psychological causes, and he himself began promoting the view he had earlier opposed. That is the psychological causation view of hysteria. Now, Freud was a Viennese neurologist who went ahead and heard about the works of Liébault and Burnham and went to study under Charcot and understand the process of hypnosis. On his return to Vienna, he actually collaborated with another of his colleagues, Joseph Breuer, and both of them began their practice of hypnosis here. And in fact, they did not practice hypnosis just the way it had been practiced by the Nancy School and others. They brought about slight variations in the process of hypnosis. For instance, they encouraged the patients to talk freely about their motives, feelings, and impulses under the hypnosis, which again came to be known as the new method of free association. They also analyzed the importance of dreams or dream analysis. And of course, as we know, Freud went forward to put forward his most influential theory of psychoanalysis, the basis of which was that mental disorders are caused by unconscious conflicts, conflicts which we are not even aware of. And of course, the field of psychoanalysis and Freud's psychoanalytic theories had the single most influential impact in the development of psychological causation for mental disorders. Now we come to the fourth and final theme that led to the development of contemporary abnormal psychology. And this is the development of the experimental tradition or the empirical tradition. The experimental tradition, in fact, can be seen to develop from the first psychological laboratory established by Wilhelm Wundt in 1879 at Leipzig in Germany, where he encouraged an empirical and experimental observation and analysis of abnormal behavior. Now, one student, James McKean Cattle, he came to the United States and he brought this method of experimentation to the United States while trying to assess individual differences in mental processing and intelligence. And he established a number of laboratories across the US. Now, another student of Wundt was Leitner Wittmer, and he is a very influential person because he was the person who established the very first psychological clinic in the University of Pennsylvania, and this clinic focused on understanding the problems of mentally deficient children. Moreover, Wittmer also encouraged a number of other psychologists to actually move away from theory and practice their discipline and open psychological clinics. Now, William Healy was yet another important person because he established the Chicago Juvenile Psychopathic Institute, where juvenile delinquents were studied. And one important factor was that Healy recognized the importance of socio-cultural factors in juvenile delinquency, perhaps the earliest person to recognize the importance of socio-cultural factors. There were other improvements also. For instance, the Journal of Abnormal Psychology was founded by Morton Prince in 1906. And another journal, the Psychological Clinic, was founded by Leitner Wittmer in 1907. Now, another key development in the experimental approach was the rise of the behaviorists. The behaviorists felt that we should reject all other earlier notions such as mind and thinking and the unconscious and focus only on observable behavior. And they believed that environmental stimuli and environmental reinforcements that a person receives are the basis for all kinds of mental disorders. And of course, the behaviorist school